Hi everyone, how are you today? Welcome back. And if you are new here, welcome to my channel, where you can learn the real world coding experience. And this is Huang, the coding expert. If you want to pass the CPC exam, COC exam, CCS-P, or any outpatient coding exam to start your coding career, or if you are already holding a coding credential, working in the field, and want to learn more in order to advance your coding profession, then you are in the right place. It has been a few months since I started the CBC exam prep video series, and I am very happy to know that many of you already passed the CBC exam successfully, and then kindly sharing your good news with me and our viewers. You can read the comments under each video and find out for yourself. I would like to take this opportunity to thank them for sharing and inspiring others to continue learning and preparing for this exam. For those of you who are waiting to take this exam, please be patient. Continue watching my videos, taking notes, typing your books, highlighting your codes, reading the coding guidelines, then sooner or later, your time will shine as well. Slowly but surely, you are getting there. Remember, what you learn from my videos is not just for this exam, but also for your own knowledge when you are going out there and working in the real world of coding. I spend a lot of time for this video because I really want you to do well, and all I'm asking in return is your full support. The future of my channel will depend significantly on you. Today's topic is how to pass the CBC exam guarantee in 2020 Part 14, hands-on practice, so that you will have a chance to apply what you have learned into tackling question and case study. So without further ado, let's get right into it. Let's take a couple minutes to go over the CBC exam session in order to check our progress up to this point. So far, I have covered the integumentary system, the musculoskeletal system, the respiratory cardiovascular systems, the digestive system, the urinary system, the nervous system, the evaluation and management, the anesthesia, the radiology, the laboratory pathology, the medicine, the medical terminology, the anatomy. All the medical terminology, anatomy, and physiology, I just wanted to let you know that I have received your request about making separate videos to cover this topic, and I will be working on it as soon as I can in the order of important areas that I want you to learn. ACTEN-CM, the HCPC Level 2, the coding guidelines. My advice for you is that, in addition to watching my videos, you also need to read the official coding guidelines. I post inside my free coding course so that you can download it. The compliance and regulatory. As you can tell, I have covered all areas of the CBC exam. So from now on, I will be focusing on question and case study. So it is time for you to practice and apply what you have learned. What you need for my videos from now on are an ACTEN-CM book, a CBT manual book, a HCPC Level 2 book, notepad, highlighters, pens and pencil, and a quiet place that you can focus and study. And last but not least is your positive mental attitude, which is the most important element in addition to my tips and strategy that will help you to pass the exam successfully. Also, just a friendly suggestion that if you have any question for me, when you type in the comment section below, please give me a reference, for example, the case number or which minute of the video, so that I know exactly what you refer to and I don't have to watch the entire video to search for your code. Also, please do not email me your homework from school or from other online class and expect me to go over it. I don't really have time to do that. My time is focused on making this video for everyone. So thank you so much for your understanding. All right, I'm ready for question and case study. Are you? Let's do it. Question number one. What is the time limit when assigning a sequela layer fetch calls? A. At least 30 days beyond the injury or illness causing the sequela layer fetch. B. There is a sliding scale of time limits on sequela layer fetch in the IC-10-CM appendix. C. When the physician documents the illness or injury as chronic. And D. There is no time limit on sequela layer fetch call. I will give you 15 seconds to tell me what would be the correct answer for this question. Your time starts now. If you pick D, congratulations, that's right. According to the IC-10 coding guidelines, there is no time limit when sequela or layer fetch call can be used. For example, when you call hemiparesis, dysphagia due to layer fetch of CVA or stroke, there is no time limit. And if you read IC-10 coding guidelines, you should know about this guideline. If you didn't read it yet, now you know. Please take note. Let's move on to the next question. Question number two. When coding for HIV, what following statement is false? Again, when coding for HIV, which following statement is false? A. Code only confirmed cases. Exception is for hospital inpatient guideline, which state if the diagnosis documented at the time of discharge is qualified as probable, suspected, likely, questionable, possible, or still to be ruled out. Code the condition as if existed or was established. B. If a patient is admitted for an HIV-related condition, the principal diagnosis should be B20, followed by additional diagnosis code for all reported HIV-related conditions. C. If a patient is being seen to determine his HIV status, use code G71.7. And D. If the HIV test is positive and the patient is asymptomatic, report code G21. In order to answer this question, you need to look up this code in your IC-10-CM book. B20, G71.7, and G21. Please pause the video and do it now. Assuming you already did and hear what you find. B20, Human Immunodeficiency Virus, HIV disease. G71.7, Human Immunodeficiency Virus, HIV counseling. And G71, asymptomatic human immunodeficiency virus HIV infection status. I will give you 30 seconds to let me know what would be the correct answer for this question. Your time starts now. If you pick C, congratulations, good thinking. A is the correct statement. Unlike outpatient coding guidelines, we cannot code probable, suspected, likely, questionable, possible, are still to be ruled out. However, for hospital inpatient, if the diagnosis documented at the time of discharge is qualified as probable, suspected, likely, questionable, are still to be ruled out, code condition as if existed or was established. B is also the correct statement. If a patient is admitted for HIV-related condition, the principal diagnosis should be B20, which is human immunodeficiency virus HIV disease, followed by additional diagnosis code for all reports HIV-related condition. D is also correct. If the HIV test is positive and the patient is asymptomatic, report G21 for asymptomatic human immunodeficiency virus HIV infection started. C. If a patient is being seen to determine his HIV status, use code G71 is not correct. This code G71.7 is for HIV counseling only, and not for determining the patient's HIV status. That said, the correct answer of this case is C. Let's move on to the next case. Case number 1. Follow my tips and strategy. A and B have the same code, A 87.A, so they are in the same group. C and D have the different codes, A 87.9 and R 50.9, so they are in a separate group. Now you know there are three codes that you need to look up in your IC10CM book, A 87.A, A 87.9, and R 50.9. Please pause the video and do it now. Assuming you already looked them up in your IC10CM book and hear what you find. A 87.A, autoviral meningitis. A 87.9, viral meningitis unspecified. And R 50.9, fever unspecified. Follow my tips and strategy. You highlight the key difference between each diagnosis code. And when you're done highlighting, you should know what your focuses are when you read the report. Let's find out. A patient is admitted to the hospital with fever and severe headache. Diagnostic workup reveal viral meningitis. Patient also has asthma with acute exacerbation and hypertension, both of which are treated. What are the correct codes for this admission? You already highlighted the difference between each diagnosis code and also the key elements in the report. I'll give you 15 seconds to tell me what would be the correct answer for this case. Your time starts now. If you pick C, congratulations, good for you. Based on the report, the diagnostic workup revealed viral meningitis. However, it does not specify which type of virus, so we have to use A 87.9 for viral meningitis unspecified. That said, C is the only answer that had A 87.9, so it's the correct answer. Now, for your own knowledge, just like cough and fever are signs and symptoms of pneumonia, fever, dysuria, abdominal pain are signs and symptoms of UTI, urinary tract infection. In this case, fever and headache are signs and symptoms of viral meningitis, so they are not called separately. According to the IC10 coding guidelines, codes that describe signs and symptoms are acceptable only when a related definitive diagnosis has not been established or confirmed by the physician. In this case, a definitive diagnosis viral meningitis has been established after the diagnostic workup, so we do not assign COVID-19 symptoms. Having said that, the correct answer for this case is C, A87.9 for viral meningitis, G45.901 for asthma with acute exacerbation, and I10 for hypertension, both are treated. Let's move on to the next case. Case number 2. Follow my tips and strategy. C and D have the same code, EA6.0, so they are in the same group. A and B have different codes, K52.9 and A09, so they are in separate groups. Now you know there are three codes that you need to look up in your ICD-10-CM book, K52.9, A09, and E86.0. Please pause the video and do it now. Assuming you already looked them up in your ICD-10-CM book and hear what you find. K50.9, non-infective gastroenteritis and colitis unspecified. A09, infectious gastroenteritis and colitis unspecified. And E86.0, dehydration. Follow my tips and strategy. You highlight the key difference between each diagnosis code, and once you're done, you should know what your focus are. Let's find out. A patient is admitted to the hospital with acute dehydration, secondary to nausea and vomiting, that's due to acute gastroenteritis. Patient is treated for dehydration. What are the correct codes for this admission? You already highlight the key difference between each diagnosis code and also the key elements in the report. I will give you 15 seconds to tell me what would be the correct answer for this case. Your time starts now. If you pick D, congratulations, you are on the right track now. The patient was admitted for the symptom that led to the dehydration. And in this case, the dehydration was treated and that will be the principal diagnosis. If you take the CCS exam, you should be familiar with this case because they want to see if you incorrectly assign the acute gastroenteritis at the principal diagnosis instead of dehydration. Let's say if this patient is admitted directly to the endoscopy unit and have an ECG performed to find out what is the cause of the acute gastroenteritis, then acute gastroenteritis should be designated as the principal diagnosis, but not in this case. The report clearly indicates that the patient is treated for dehydration. So E86.0, dehydration, is the principal diagnosis and must be listed first. Nausea and vomiting as signs and symptoms of acute gastroenteritis, so they are not called separately according to the coding guidelines that I just mentioned on the first case. Having said that, the correct answer for this case is D, E86.0 for dehydration and K50.9 for non-infective gastroenteritis. I hope that you follow me okay. Let's move on to the next case. Case number 3. Follow my tips and strategy. A and D have the same code, 57160, so they are in the same group. B and D have the different code, 58300 and 11976, so they are in separate groups. Now you know there are three codes that you need to look up in your CPT book, 57160, 58300 and 11976, please pause the video and do it now. Assuming you already looked them up in your CBT book and hear what you find. 57160, fitting and insertion of bessary or other intravascular support device. 58300, insertion of intrauterine device, IUD. And 11976, removal implantable contraceptive capsules. Follows my tips and strategy. You highlight the key difference between each CPT code, and after you're done, you should have an idea what your focus should be when you read the report. Let's find out. A 45-year-old woman is seen in the clinic for a bessary fitting. The physician inserts the bessary ring, asking the patient as to the comfort and determines if this is a good treatment for this patient's uterine prolapse. A number 7 rubber bessary ring is given to the patient for use once she is shown she can insert and remove it on her own. What is the correct coding for this service? You already highlighted the main difference between each CPT code and also the key elements in the procedure report. I'll give you 15 seconds to let me know what would be the correct CPT code to report for this procedure. Your time starts now. If you pick CBT 57160, fitting and insertion of bessary or other intravascular support device, congratulations, I know you can do it. Based on the report, the patient is seen in the clinic for a bessary fitting. A bessary is a prosthetic device that can be inserted into the vagina to support its internal structure. It's often used in the case of urinary incontinence and a vaginal or pelvic organ prolapse. 58300, insertion of intrauterine device, IUD, and 11976, removal implantable contraceptive capsules are not correct codes to use for this procedure. From here, we can eliminate B and D. A and C still remain, and the difference between two answers are A has A4562 and C has A4561. So all you have to do now is open your HCPCS level 2 book and find out what they are for. Please pause the video and do it now. Assuming you already did and hear what you got. A4561, bessary, rubber, any type. And A4562, bessary, non-rubber, any type. Based on the procedure report, the number 7 rubber bessary rings is given, so A4561 is the correct HCPCS level 2 code to use. That said, the correct answer for this case is C, 57160 and A4561. Let's move on to the next case. Case number 4. This is a short one-sentence question, so I read it first. The ambulance responded and treated the patient, but no transport was done. Call for this service. A. Nothing, because the patient was ultimately not transported to a facility. B. A0999. C. A0998. And D. A0428. Alright, I'll let you try it first yourself and let me know what would be the correct answer for this question. Please pause the video and do it now. When you're done, then you can come back and check your answer. If you pick C, A099A, congratulations, you are doing just fine. For those of you who want to follow me along, follow my tips and strategy. B, C, and D all have different answers. So all you have to do now is open your HIC pick level 2 book and look up this code, A0999, A099A, and A042A. Please pause the video and do it now. Assuming you already looked them up in your book and hear what you find. A0999, unlisted ambulance service. A0998, ambulance response and treatment, no transport. And A042A, ambulance service, basic life support, non-emergency transport. After you're done highlighting the main difference between each HCPC level 2 code, and based on the question, the ambulance responded and treated the patient, but no transport was done. So A099A's ambulance response and treatment no transport is the correct HCPC level 2 code to use. Having said that, the correct answer for this case is C. Let's move on to next case. Case number 5. Follow my tips and strategy. A and B have the same code, J2270, so they are in the same group. B and D have the same code, J2274, so they are also in the same group. Now you know there are two codes that you need to look up in your HCPC level 2 book, which are J2270 and J2274. So please pause the video and do it now. Assuming you already looked them up in your book and hear what you find. J2270 injection morphine sulfate up to 10 mg. And J2274 injection morphine sulfate preservative free or epidural or intrathecal use 10 mg. Follow my tips and strategy. You highlight the main difference between each HCPC level 2 code. And when you're done, you should have an idea what your focuses are when you read the question. Let's read it. Code for the supply of Duramorph PF sterile, no preservatives, 100 mg via intrathecal administration. All right, I'll give you 15 seconds to let me know what should be the correct answer for this case. The time starts now. If you pick D, congratulations again, you are the expert now. Based on the question, Duramorph PF, sterile, no preservative given via intrathecal administration, so the correct code to use is J2274. However, this code is only for 10 mg and the patient received 100 mg, so 10 units are needed to report in this case. That said, the correct answer for this case is D, J2274 times 10 units. Just a friendly reminder that if you have enjoyed what you have learned so far and appreciate my time spent for this video, then you could please pause the video, click the like, subscribe, and share buttons below to support my channel. That would be great. You are the reason why I continue working hard on this video. It's a very time consuming and it's also free, so I don't think it is too much to ask for your support. Thank you so much, and we should move on to the next case. Case number 6. If you want to try it yourself first, then please pause the video and do it now, and come back when you're done to check the answer. If you want to follow me along, then let's do it. This case is very straightforward. A, B, C, and D all have different code. 65779, 65778, 65770, and 657-80. So all you have to do now is open your CPT book and look them up. Please pause the video and do it now. Assuming you already did and hear what you got. 65770, keratoprothesis. 65770A, placement of amniotic membranes on the ocular surface without suture. 65779, this is an identical, so it includes all the information from the code above 65770A, which is the parenchyma, except it is for single layer suture. And 65780, ocular surface reconstruction, amniotic membrane transplantation, multiple layers. Follow my tips and strategy. You highlight the main difference between each CPT code. And after you're done with this step, you should have an idea what your focus would be when you read the procedure report. Remember, this step is very important. If you highlight them appropriately, then the next step will be much easier for you, which is to find out what is in the report that match what you highlight. Let's find out. A 30-year-old female present with progressive loss of vision, severe pain, tearing in the eye, and light sensitivity in her right eye immediately after being scratched accidentally by her baby son. Examination revealed severe ocular inflammation and a large corneal epithelial defect. Decision was made to place an amniotic membrane in the eye. After application of topical anesthetic, the amniotic membrane is inserted into the conjunctival fornix and centered over the corneal surface. Sutures are used to skill placement. Patient tolerated the procedure well. What procedure and diagnosis code are reported? Alright, you already know the difference between each CPT code and also highlighted the key elements in the report. I will give you 15 seconds to tell me what will be the correct answer for this case. The time starts now. If you pick A, congratulations, you must have been practicing. Based on the procedure report, an amniotic membrane is placed and the suture also used to secure the membranes in place. So 65779 is the correct CPT code for this procedure. 65770A is also for the placement of amniotic membranes but without suture. So it's not the correct code to use. Having said that, the correct answer for this case is A. 65779S05.01XA and W50.4XXA. Now you know, if you follow my tips and strategy, you don't even have to look up the second set or third set of code and you still can nail the answer. I hope you get it. Let's bring it on. Case number 7. Follow my tips and strategy. A and B have the same code, 32555, so they are in the same group. C and D have the same code, 32554, so they are also in the same group. Now you know, there are two codes that you need to look up in your CPT book, 32555 and 32554. So please pause the video and do it now. Assuming you already looked them up in your CPT book and hear what you find. 32554, thoracentesis, needle or catheter, aspiration of the pleural space without imaging guidance. And 32555, this is an identical, so it includes all the information from the code above 32554, which is the parent code, except is done with imaging guidance. Follow my tip and strategy. You highlight the main difference between each cervical, and once you're done, you go tell the all the difference between 32554 and 32555 is 32555 thoracentesis performed with imaging guidance. So let's read the procedure report and find out. A 40-year-old male is seen today for a thoracentesis to treat a right pleural effusion. Dr. Kimball will use ultrasonic guidance to place the needle. The effusion is identified under guidance and a pocket approximately 4 cm. Inside is entered by a needle and straw color fluid is aspirated in the needle, which is tagged and sent to the lab for examination. Patient tolerated the procedure well. What CBT and ICD-10-CM codes are reported. I will give you 15 seconds to let me know what would be the correct answer for this case. Your time start now. If you pick B, congratulations, you figured that out fast. Based on the procedure report, thoracentesis is performed under ultrasound guidance, so 32555 is the correct code to use. From here, we can eliminate C and D. A and B still remain. And the difference between these two answers is A has 76942, and B doesn't have it. If you call long enough, then you should recognize 70,000 series is an imaging code. Then you should know the answer now. If you are new, then pause the video and look up this code and find out what it's for. Please pause the video and do it now. Assuming you already did and hear what you get. 76942. Ultrasonic guidance for needle placement, for example, biopsy, aspiration, injection, localized device, imaging supervision and interpretation. You can tell 32555 already include imaging, so you do not need to report 76942. Also, if you read the note under code 32557, you should see. Do not report this code range 32554 to 32557 in conjunction with 76942. These are imaging code. That said, the correct answer for this case is B 32555 and G90 for pleural effusion. Let's move on to the next case. Case number A, as I said before, if you want to do it yourself and see how you're doing, please pause the video and do it now, and then come back when you're done. For those of you who want to follow me along, then let's do it. Follow my tips and strategy. A and C have the same code, 58555, so they are in the same group. B and D have the same code, 58558. So they are also in the same group. Now you know there are two codes that you need to look up in your CBT book, 58555 and 58558. Please pause the video and do it now. Assuming you already looked them up in your CBT book and hear what you got. 58555, hysteroscopy, diagnostic, separate procedure. And 58558, hysteroscopy, surgical, with sampling, biopsy of endometrium and or bulbectomy, with or without DNC, dilation and colitis. Follow my tips and strategy. You highlight the main difference between these two codes, and once you're done, you should have an idea what your focus should be when you read the procedure report. For example, in this case, You need to find out if a diagnosis hysteroscopy is performed or a hysteroscopy with biopsy is performed. Let's find out. A 50-year-old female presented today for irregular uterine bleeding. It is decided that a hysteroscope and DNC of the uterus is in order. After induction of general anesthesia, the cervix was grasped with a single tooth tenaculum and sharp endocervical curettage was done. The endocervical canal was then dilated to 7 cm with Tegger dilators. A 5.0 mm Olympus hysteroscope was introduced. The cavity was inspected and removed a sample of uterine lining. The hysteroscope was then withdrawn and a sharp endometrial curettage was done. Patient tolerated the procedure well. What are the correct codes for this case? I'll give you 15 seconds to let me know what would be the correct CPC code for this procedure. Your time start now. If you pick 5A55A, good for you. Based on the procedure report, both the biopsy and DNC, dilation and curettage was done. So 5A55A is the correct code to use. From here, we can eliminate A and C. B and D still remain, and the only difference between these two answers is the ICD-10 diagnosis code. B has N92.1 and D has N93.9. So all you have to do now is to look them up in your ICD-10-CM book. Please pause video and do it now. Assuming you already did and hear what you got. N92.1 excessive and frequent menstruation with irregular cycle. And N93.9 abdominal, uterine, and vaginal bleeding unspecified. Based on the procedure report, the patient presents for irregular uterine bleeding and not for excessive and frequent menstruation. So, N92.9 is the correct code to you. That said, the correct answer for this case is D, 5A55A, and N93.9. This is your homework for this week. I'll go over it in the next video. I want you to tackle it yourself using my tips and strategy. To be fair to everyone, please do not email me or type your answer in the comment section. I don't want people to see your answer and then don't even want to do it themselves. So I hope that you understand. I really want each and every one of you to pass the exam successfully, and that is why I am trying very hard on this video, and all I ask in return is your support by liking, sharing, and subscribing to my channel. That is all for today. Thank you so much for watching, for liking, and sharing this video. If you find this video helpful, informative, and easy to learn with this format, or if you have any suggestion, then please leave me a comment below just to let me know. I really appreciate it. Also, the more comments that you leave for me, the better chance for my video will be reviewed by other people. So please continue to do so. Until next time, have a great day.